Peace be to you and grace from him who freed us from our sins, who loved us all and shed his blood that we might be saved, the one who was and who is to come, even Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen and alleluia. Please be seated. Grief therapists. They tell us that we need to see our dead, that we actually need to look at them. We need to go to the visitation. We need to go to the funeral. We need to go to the burial. I know it sounds grim, but they say we need to actually see them in the casket. We need to see them buried. We need to wipe the tears away from our eyes and take a good look. They say it's good for us. It can start to bring us closure. It can start to begin the healing process. This All Saints Day, we don't have any open caskets here for you to look into. But we remember those who we have buried just the same. We Christians are a strange group, for today we do something that will likely cause us pain. Something that will cause us to shed a tear, maybe, or two. For grief and for pain. We'll speak the names of those who have died, those who we have buried in the last year. And we'll be sad when we say their names because they're not with us. They're not here. When we say those names, you'll probably remember others who you too have lost, others who have left and left you to wander the world alone. You'll think of these people who have left you, and the wounds on your heart may ache a little more. Maybe it was a spouse, maybe it was a parent, maybe even a child. A friend, a confidant, a mentor, or a colleague, without them in the world seems to be a poorer place. So why on earth do we bring it up? It seems needless, maybe even cruel, to poke you where it hurts and to prompt your suffering, to pour salt into the proverbial wound. But the grief therapists are sort of right in a way. Death is not easy to deal with. And if we're ever going to get better, you can be sure that there is going to be a bit of pain involved, maybe even a lot of pain involved. That's because there is no easy way of dealing with death. The only way that we can deal with death is to face it head on, to look at it, to stare it down. It's the only way that tears can ever change into alleluias. Death is something that we as humans have been dealing with for a long time now. Been dealing with it from the beginning. Well, since the fall, that is. And I can only begin to imagine the shock, the pain, the horror, the devastation that must have been Adam and Eve's when they found their son Abel dead, struck down in the fury of his brother Cain. He was the first human being that they ever saw that was lifeless. It was unnatural, and in its way, it was its worst. It was one of the worst kinds of death. It was a death where parents had to bury a son. It was a death, but not just any death. It was murder, and not just murder, but it was fratricide. Brother killing brother. That day, Adam and Eve didn't just lose Abel, they lost Cain as well, and that day, Abel lost his very life. It was unnatural, and we still feel the pain of it every time we see death. Our sorrows, our griefs, and our pains are all sourced in that original wound of God's creation, which is original sin. The sin of our first parents has messed up the whole world. Now we cannot see clearly or true or far. Instead, we see the world upside down and backwards through tears. Everything is obscured. We live by half the data, we live by half the truth, and so sometimes we come to the wrong conclusions. We see death and we say, oh, that's normal. That's just a part of the life cycle, a natural course of life running out. Or maybe death isn't normal, but it's our master. It's that which will vanquish every one of us. It will take us someday, whether we like it or not. It won't ask us if we're ready. It won't ask us if our family is ready. It'll take us. It's no wonder we cry. How can these tears ever become hallelujahs? Well, Genesis chapter 4 is not the last time that we ever see Abel. We see Abel in one of our readings for today. We see him in Revelation, standing at the foot of the throne of God, soaked through with the blood of the Lamb. In that place, he is sheltered from heat and from hunger. He doesn't have to worry about pain or tears. He is protected from the rage of his brother, and he has work to do there. That original work of glorifying God, that work that his parents were first tasked with. There his joy is complete and full and perfect. And he can see so, so clearly. It's all alleluia for him there. What if we could see true? What if we could see clear? And what if we could see far right now? If we were purely rational beings, we wouldn't cry. We wouldn't cry tears of sorrow. How could we, when those who we love, we see them with Abel, that host that John sees arrayed in white? Who are these other than those who have died in the Lord? Those, our brothers and our sisters, our friends and our family who have died in Christ, who have trusted in his promises, who have washed their robes and made them white in his blood. What if we too, right now, were soaked through with the blood of Jesus? What if we could see true and clear and far? Imagine how great life would be. It would be all alleluias. So how can we ever stop crying? On our own, this isn't possible, guys. On our own, we can never shake the sight of death, that corpse in the casket. We've seen too much. We simply can't unsee it for all we try. And I think that's the point of what the grief therapists want you to do. They want you to see it. They want you to see that cold, hard reality time and time again, and they want it to deaden and they want it to dull. And deaden and dull it might, but this way of seeing death can never, ever lead to alleluia. And so on this All Saints Day, we take our own dose of reality. This is the way we deal with death, and it's similar but different. We have to face death head on. We have to beat death at its own game. So we die. We die now. We die early and we die often. We die before death can get a grip on us. We die so much that dying doesn't matter anymore. And if you're willing to accept it, we even die by Jesus' own hand. We die right over there, in the water of that font. The church has always seen baptism as dying. Romans chapter 6, we were buried therefore with Jesus by baptism into death. We die ahead of time. And for some of us, we die even when we were a little baby. No thought of death on our minds, and yet we die before death can get to us. But the church has also seen baptism as new life. For those who have been baptized into Jesus, into his death, are also baptized into his resurrection. Just as he has died and is risen, those who are baptized shall rise. So we beat death at its own game. Where else do you think this host arrayed in white washed their robes? When do you think it happened? Where did it happen? Do you think that they died and went to heaven And there they were finally close enough to Jesus. There they were finally in contact with him. They had access to his blood. And there they could wash their robes. Do you think that's how it worked? I think that their robes were washed long before, guys. That's where they washed their robes. For in the dear forgiving flood of water and the word, they were sprinkled with the blood of Christ. Why else is a baptismal gown white? You see us bringing these kids up here to get baptized dressed in white. Why is that? I'll tell you, it's not because they're good little Christians. They're bad. It's because in that moment of baptism, that is the first time a person is soaked through with the blood of the Lamb. And so our loved ones, our family, our friends, our spouses, parents, children, confidants, mentors, and colleagues, our brothers and sisters in Christ, so they lived as those who had already died, as those who had death in their rearview mirror. And so they clung to the words of Jesus, and so they clung to the sacraments. For they knew that that which they had been sealed with in their baptisms would continue to be nourished through their ears and through their mouths. And so they listened. And so they ate, and so they drank. And so they continued to be soaked through and through with the blood of Jesus day after day, soaked through to the bone. And they have been singing Alleluia since the beginning. If you want to stop crying and you want to live again, if you want to see clearly and true and far, if you want to heal and laugh and sing now, today, ahead of time, then come to the font and come to the supper. Make the sign of the cross when you hear those words spoken, the name into which you were baptized, the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Remember, you are baptized, you have been washed. Come to the supper, take the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, which was poured out for you. The body of Christ who was slain. The body of Christ who is risen that you might beat death. Take everything that he has to give you. Take his baptism, take his supper, take his word, take his forgiveness, take his love, take his life. And so you can start living as those who have gone before us, as that host that is arrayed in white. Now that you have died ahead of time, you can start living ahead of time. So, brothers and sisters, we live. We live now. We live early and we live often. We live before death can get a grip on us. We live so much that dying doesn't matter anymore because death isn't our master, Jesus is. And if you're willing to accept it, we live by Jesus' own hand. And one day you will be reunited with your brothers and sisters in Christ. You will see them there at the throne of the Lamb, washed through with the blood of Christ, and there you will be with saints and angels in joy forever. I know this for certain, because John saw it. He saw a host arrayed in white, those who washed their robes. There he saw Abel. And next to Abel, he saw your loved ones. And in the midst of your loved ones, he saw you. He saw you. Because you too have washed your robes in white. Grief therapists tell us that we need to see our dead, that it's good for us. God tells us the same thing, but he gives us a better way of seeing them than the grief therapists ever could. For we see them in Revelation, clothed in white, and we see ourselves there with them too. And we sing alleluias for God, for Jesus has become our salvation. And there we need not wipe the tears from our eyes to get a better look, for he has already wiped away every tear from our eye. Now we can see clearly. Even so, Lord Jesus, quickly come, and night will be no more. There we will need no light, nor lamp, nor sun to see clearly, for Christ will be our all. Amen and Alleluia.